Football has provided us with many incredible stories, but this is undoubtedly one of the most impressive. He escaped poverty, nearly gave up on football, and even when he got his chance, it took years before he finally made it. And once he did, he broke records, used his influence to save his country from a literal war, and went on to become arguably the most clutch player of all time. A big game monster that nobody could stop. And today, I'll tell you all about it. Welcome to the life of Didier Drogba. It all started in the worst way possible for young Didier. The Ivory Coast was in the midst of a sharp economic decline, and even though his parents were pursuing a career in banking, soon even they would have no way to provide for their son. And in an act of desperation, they would send him to France. As he arrived at the airport, he had a sign strapped around his neck, saying Didier Drogba to meet Michel Goba. Goba was his uncle, a footballer who played at Stade Bretois and who had financed his move to France. From the get-go, his parents made sure to say that he was not to be put into a football academy. He had to focus on school, but his uncle, loving football as much as he did, immediately signed him up for training. There was some back and forth, but after much debating, his uncle convinced him to let him play as a hobby. As much as his uncle tried to keep Didier happy, by the age of 8, he had been completely devoured by homesickness. He missed his parents so much, he was willing to endure wherever it took. So, he went back to the Ivory Coast. After 3 years there, where he mostly played in a parking lot with his friends, the economic crisis worsened, and once again the parents were forced to send Drogba to be with his uncle. This time around, he began taking football more seriously, and oddly enough, he would choose to start playing as a right back. It would be his uncle who would tell him, "People only care about the strikers, you need to play up front." And so, he began playing as a forward. The following year, his parents would move to France as well, and oddly enough, it would be at this time that he would begin to underperform at school, being forced to go back and repeat an entire school year. His parents were so pissed at his lack of focus that they would ban him from playing football. After 1 year away from it, they would move to the suburbs of Paris and Drogba began playing for Levallois. Over the next few years, he made his name known all over town and eventually, he would be promoted to the first team and he would even score on his debut, but without any explanation, he would not be kept in the first team. By the age of 19, most big local clubs were scouting him regularly, even PSG had their eye on him, but out of nowhere, he got injured. And when I say out of nowhere, I mean it. He was literally in the middle of a match when he ran off the pitch, tripped on a sprinkler head, and slammed his body into a wall. The hit for his signing cooled down, but still, Le Mans took the chance, and Drogba moved to their city. At this point, it seemingly was make it or break it for the striker, and everything just went wrong. Over the next 2 years, he fractured two of his metatarsals, his fibula and his ankle. Drogba was in his 20s without any prospects of a career in football, and with his first son on the way, he soon decided to focus on his studies instead. By the age of 21, Drogba had finished his accounting degree and, fun fact by the way, apparently even to this day he is still enrolled as a certified accountant, which is hilarious. At this point in time, life would throw him a curveball. As he seemed closer and closer to giving up on the dream rather than pursue it, Le Mans decided to, after only 2 competitive games in a previous season, offer him his first professional contract. There was some hesitation, but Drogba had to take it, and so, on his first season, he would score 7 goals in 32 matches. These numbers weren't the most impressive, and an injury over the preseason would see his spot being taken over by another player. Drogba would be benched, and when used, he would be put on the wing. He struggled a lot, only scoring once throughout the whole season. By his third, he had bounced back a bit, but he was still not playing as well as they'd hope him to be. And so, when Jean-Gon proposed a move in January, hoping Drogba would replace their striker Fiorese, who had just moved to PSG, they decided it would be the best for all parties that he left. Once at his new club, the coach put 100% faith in Drogba, being completely convinced that he would become a top player. This leap of faith would be key to the development of Drogba, who at 23 was finally being given a chance at the top tier of French football. On his first match, he scored and immediately would be on the fans' good side, but the rest of the season lacked good performances and soon, everyone would start losing confidence in his abilities. At this point, Drogba was closing in on 25 years of age and something had to change, and so Drogba picked himself back up and even told the coaches he wanted to stay and prove his worth. What followed was 21 goals in 39 matches for a team who had just barely escaped relegation. This year changed everything. It brought him a 7th place finish and qualification for the Intertoto Cup. It brought him his first few matches, goals and even his first hat-trick for the Ivory Coast national team. But above all, it brought him the notoriety necessary in order to complete his dream move. Didier Drogba was moving to Marseille, only 1 year after his signing to Guingamp for €150,000. It would cost Marseille a whole €6 million to get their man. As he arrived, they were in need of some change. They were in the early stages of their rebuild, as they attempted to come back from their awful performances over the turn of the millennium. Drogba was pretty fast to get in sync with the new team and in the Champions League. He would absolutely dominate. In the first game of the group stage, he would score against Real Madrid, then he would score all 3 goals in a win against Partizan, and finally, as they met Porto, he would score again. Unfortunately, Marseille had already been defeated twice, and his second round performances failed to meet the expectations, and they would go down to the UEFA Cup. Once there, Drogba would score the only goal against the Dnipro, then he would score 2 out of the 3 goals they scored in order to beat the mighty Liverpool. Even as Drogba missed the second leg against Inter, he would make sure to score the only goal in the first leg, and in the semi-final, he would score both goals against Newcastle. Marseille had made their way to a final while scoring a total of 8 goals in 6 matches, and 6 of them had been scored by Drogba, only made more impressive by the fact that out of the 2 goals that weren't scored by him, one of them was scored in a game he didn't even play in. To say he had been essential so far would have to be a joke. He had been everything for Marseille. Unfortunately, in the final against Valencia, the goalkeeper Fabian Barthez would give away a penalty and get sent off in the last minutes of the first half, and from then on, it was pretty much game over for Marseille. Regardless, Drogba had finished the season with an incredible 32 goals, and so, the man who just 2 years prior to this was playing in the second tier, was now the UEFA Cup top scorer, a UEFA Cup finalist, and the target of a £24 million bid from Chelsea that Marseille just couldn't refuse. This sort of meteoric rise to fame is normally associated with young players, but Drogba was 27 already, he had no time to waste. Over his first 2 seasons, his goal-scoring tally wasn't the most impressive, but he was already showing 2 of his most talked-about traits. He seemed to love the Champions League, scoring much more frequently in that specific competition, and he was clearly a player for the biggest of stages. His most notorious moments would come as he scored twice against Bayern in the quarterfinals of the Champions League, and an extra-time goal to clinch the Carling Cup against Liverpool in the first season, and then scored 2 to give his team the win over Arsenal in the Community Shield, and won the award for most assists in the league in his second year. Besides this, and even though the league seemed to be the competition in which he shined the least, he still took home 2 Premier League titles, which is always very nice, but sometime between these 2 seasons, something incredible happened. Drogba was playing the World Cup qualifiers with his national team, and he had been in great form, scoring 9 goals over the 10 games he had played, but this would be far from the highlight. You see, since the early 90s, the Ivory Coast had been in civil war. At the north, there were the Muslim rebel forces, and in the south, Christians who sided with the current government, which had taken over through some controversial elections. It seemed there was no way to achieve peace in this country. In a way, it could be seen that they were truly divided, at times seeming like they had nothing in common. But that's where Drogba came in. As the post-match interview took place, he requested the microphone, gathered his teammates and began addressing the people of the Ivory Coast, saying, "Men and women of Ivory Coast, from the north and the south, we prove today that all Ivorians can coexist and play together with a shared goal, to qualify for the World Cup. We promise that the celebration will unite the people. Today, we beg you on our knees." And at this very moment, Drogba signaled to his teammates and they all kneeled down in protest while staring at the camera. "Forgive, forgive, forgive," Please lay down your weapons, old elections, everything will be for the better. It's very easy to dismiss this as meaningless, but the Ivory Coast have been desperately in need of something to unite their people. And why not football? As Drogba, a man from the south, let out these words, he had the arm of Kolo Touré, a Muslim man from the north, wrapped over his shoulders. As players living abroad, they saw their homeland as one, when the people who were there failed to see it as such. Their words did not go unheard. Before the 2006-2007 season, Drogba would once again come in action for the Ivorian national team, scoring in 3 out of the 5 matches as they eventually lost out to Egypt in the final of the African Cup of Nations. Despite this upset, this season would be his first to be deemed legendary, and oddly enough, it would be his league performances that would stand out the most. Drogba would score 20 goals in the league and take the Golden Boot for the first time in his career. Unfortunately, Chelsea would still miss out on the title by 6 points. But to make up for this disappointment in the league, Drogba would score both goals in the Carling Cup final against Arsenal and the only goal in the FA Cup final against Man United to bring both trophies to the bridge. As you might have realized by now, Drogba really liked to score in finals. As Drogba joined the Ivory Coast once more over summer, he would realize that his words years ago had not been enough to change the path of the country, so this time around, he would adopt more drastic measures. He would persuade the president himself into moving one of the African Cup of Nations matches to the city where the Northern Rebels' stronghold was located. I'd like to know what Drogba said to him, because no one expected anything from this proposal, but somehow it happened. And as Drogba put the 5th goal into the net in injury time, the fans invaded the pitch in euphoria. No matter whether Drogba had been born in the south, he was their hero. Government officials watched from afar, and this moment facilitated negotiations, and only a few months after this, the first disarmament had been reached. For once, someone had managed to unite the people of the Ivory Coast. The beginning of the next season was tough. Mourinho left and Drogba seemed broken. He had reportedly been reduced to tears after being made aware that he would be gone soon. And he even told France Football that he played for the manager and that the team now seemed different, that he wanted to leave Chelsea. Regardless, he stayed, and by October, Drogba would hit top form and score 8 goals in 8 matches before being out for a month because of a knee injury. It's undoubtable that over his career, Drogba proved to be a legend and deserving of a high placement at the Ballon d'Or, but how he managed a 4th place finish that year is beyond me. It's not that he wasn't good, it's just that I feel like he deserved it a lot more in other years, but well, it is what it is, and it's certainly nothing to be ashamed of. The rest of the season wasn't his most impressive time either. He would only score in 4 matches over 5 months, but wow did he pick them well. He would score Chelsea's only goal in the Carabao Cup final against Tottenham, then score against Spurs once more to get the draw, then score both goals at the defeated Arsenal 2-1, and then score against Liverpool in the Champions League semi-final second leg. First to take them into extra time, and then the winning goal once they were there. He wasn't playing up to the standard, but every time they really needed him, he showed up. But then came the Champions League final against Manchester United, and not only did Drogba fail to score, which was rare for him to do in a final, but he also got a red card minutes before the penalty shootout. If only Chelsea had one more clutch penalty shooter, maybe that night would have looked much different. Eventually, it would even be confirmed that Drogba, had he been available, would have been the one to take the 5th penalty kick and not John Terry, who famously slipped. Just like this, we were approaching 2009. Drogba was 31 years old already, and it was evident just how fast the clock was ticking. Injuries came up, and by November, Drogba had missed 15 matches and over 135 days. By the time he was back, Anelka had taken his place in the team, and only in February, by the time Gus Iding had taken over Scolari's spot, would Drogba get it back. Impressively, from the first time he played a full 90 under Gus Iding, he started performing, scoring 9 goals over the next 11 games, including goals in all 4 Champions League matches he played against Liverpool and Juventus. Unfortunately, in the semi-finals, Barcelona would beat them on away goals in an incredible matchup that saw the referee refuse penalty appeal after penalty appeal and eventually spawned the famous clip of Drogba yelling at the cameras that the match had been a disgrace. This match would become one of the most famous refereeing scandals of all time, and it's still frequently referenced to this day. By the end of the season, Chelsea had only won the FA Cup, and as you might imagine, Drogba scored in the final. And right as one of his poorest seasons in terms of goal scoring ended, Drogba started one of his best. Over the 2009-2010 season, he would score 37 goals in 44 matches playing under Carlo Ancelotti. These included 2 goals against Atletico to tie the away match in the UCL group stage, 4 against Arsenal in the 2 league matches they played, 1 to give them a late win over United, and finally get Chelsea to first place in the league, and another one to give them the win in the final of the FA Cup. If not for an early exit against Mourinho's Inter in the Champions League, this could have been the perfect year for Drogba. Still, 3 titles and a golden boot were impressive enough. This season could have led anyone to believe that Drogba was here to stay for a bunch more years despite his age, but in reality, it would be his last incredible season for Chelsea. Though there were still some, if not the most incredible moments to come. After a season that left us with not much to remember, the 2011-2012 season would see Drogba leave with a bang. He would only play 2 group stage matches in the Champions League and would still manage to score the only goal against Leverkusen and get 2 goals and 1 assist in the 3-0 win over Valencia. Then, in the last 16, he would get the first goal as Chelsea started an incredible comeback against Napoli, and eventually, he would even assist the winner on extra time. In the first leg with Barcelona in the semi-finals, he would score the only goal. Still, this was a narrow margin, and with 2009 still very fresh in everyone's memory, no one was surprised once Barcelona had gone 2 goals in front at the Camp Nou, but then, suddenly everything went Chelsea's way. Messi missed the penalty, Ramirez scored, and then out of nowhere, as Chelsea seemed bound to concede the third, Fernando Torres on the counter-attack sealed their spot in the Champions League final against Bayern. Once again, Chelsea were far from favourites, and though they held on for a while, on the 83rd minute, Müller scored. It seemed like a done deal to most, but not to Drogba, and so, as he had done so many times, he scored in a final to make sure Chelsea stayed afloat. This was the most important goal of his career. On extra time, Schär saved the penalty. On the shootout, Schweinsteiger missed. And this time around, Drogba was there to take his penalty, and so Chelsea had to become champions of Europe in what would be Drogba's last match for the club. Following this, Drogba would join Shanghai Shenhua, though he would only play 11 matches before moving on to Galatasaray. An incredible club with a history of taking in stars and providing them with a fire needed to go a few more years. As he arrived, Drogba was still a European champion and he was welcomed like the king he truly was. Joining a squad with the likes of Schneider, Altintop, Muslera and Eboué. The same old story would follow him to Turkey. He wouldn't score that many, but when they needed, he always did. On his debut, his goal made a difference as they won 2-1. The next time he scored twice to give them the win again. Then he scored against Real Madrid and they won again. And in the only other match he scored that season, once again he scored twice to put them in front 3-1. In his second season, he started by scoring the only goal in the Super Cup against Fenerbahce, then scored to tie the match against Antalyaspor, and scored and assisted as Galatasaray tied with Juventus 2-2. These performances are just not normal. He only scored when he needed them the most. It's freakish, to say the least. Drogba was the ultimate mentality monster. Over the rest of the season, he scored and assisted on another 10 occasions, even giving them a win over Juventus in the process. Everyone would have loved to see this relationship continue. It was a joy to see, especially for the Galatasaray fans. But then came his victory lap. Mourinho had joined Chelsea once again, and he didn't hesitate to call up Drogba and get the band back together for one more season. After all, given these performances, who cares if he's 36? Drogba would play as a super sub, and in the first few months he was amazing, at one point even scoring or assisting 8 times in 11 matches despite playing just 505 minutes. That averages out to a goal or assist every 63 minutes, absolutely world class. Over the second half of the season, he became less and less necessary, and by then, even though Chelsea would win the Premier League, he would announce his departure to the MLS. His first season there would be incredible, scoring 12 goals in 14 matches, but over time he lost his ambition, and 4 seasons later, he had officially retired. Drogba said his last goodbye to the world of football as a certified winner, an Ivorian legend on and off the field, one of Chelsea's all-time greats and arguably the most clutch player of all time. Having scored 9 goals in 9 finals during his first stint with Chelsea, only ever failing to score in one, the 2008 UCL final. This is a record for the ages, a show of how far your mindset can take you in football. So yeah, that was it. I hope you enjoyed. And if you did, don't forget to leave a like and subscribe. So yeah, I'll see you next time. Bye.